We last saw the Carpi cross the Danube to sack Philip the Arab's empire, but they weren't alone. Led by Argaithus and the mysterious Ostrogoza, an amalgamation of Goths and Quadi crossed the Great River and ran straight for the coastline settlements of Moesia, in the Black Sea coast. Regarding these two very obscure figures, The Origins and Deeds of the Goths by Charles C. Mierow says that Ostrogoza led 300,000 Goths across the Danube, along with some Taifali, Vandalas Dingi, and Peuquini, a small branch of the Bastarnae, located in the Danube Delta. Under his rule, he allegedly sent Argaitus and a certain Gumtheric as his commanders. Of course, we must take the 300,000 forces with a pinch of salt, as it may very possibly be quite exaggerated. However, this gives us light as to who attacked and who was leading the armies, something we couldn't get with the Carpi that simultaneously strike the southeast of Dacia. Thosimus's new history doesn't mention the Goths in any way, focusing mostly in the Carpi siege that I explained in the last video. Regarding Ostrogoza, he was supposedly the forefather of the Ostrogoths, the initial division of the until now homogeneous Goths. History of the Goths by Herwig Wolfram mentions Ostrogoza as the preceding ruler to Gniva, who would achieve great fame after killing Emperor Decius in Abritus. However, he places both Argaitus and Gunteric as commanders of Gniva in 250, and not during the attacks that happened under Philip. The Mal genealogy, created by Theodoric the Great in the late 5th century, explains the relation between the Amali Ostrogoths and Ostrogoza, citing the latter as part of his dynasty and the first Ostrogoth king, son of Isarna, the first Amali. About Argaitus and Gunteric, nothing is ever said. Basing only on Thosimus and Zonaras, though, the historicity of Ostrogoza is put in doubt, while the existence of Argaitus would be made far more solid. Only time and new hypothetical sources will be able to find the truth. Going slightly forward in time and returning to the proper attack, once again Severianus, brother-in-law or father-in-law of Emperor Philip the Arab, failed to quell the attacks, but with the Roman armies busy farther west, there was nothing that could stop the invading tribes. Why they went against Marcianopolis is discutable, but what makes more sense is that the local Roman garrison simply retreated back to behind their walls in major cities like Oescus and Nicopolis ad Istrum, the major cities of the zone. Not even Tomis, later renamed Constantia and capital of Moesia Inferior, reported any attacks. Whatever may be the reason, they did achieve a lot of loot from their attack on Marcianopolis. Following a brief siege, and possibly with the population realizing that nobody would come to save them, they surrender, paying a great sum of gold to the gods and their companions to get them to go away. And they did. They simply retreated back to their behind the Danube, with their newly acquired goods in around 248, prior to Pacatianus' usurpation attempt. However, even though all the things related to the Romans end right here, as we hear no more of Ostrogoza and Argaitus in later raids, Charles C. Mierow's Origins and Deeds of the Goths mentions another situation that took place on the other side of the Danube. Even though he mentions the Getae, there hasn't been a mention before of them, so I will assume that he meant Goths. This point is further reinforced with the fact that he calls the Gepids kinsmen of them. Of course, Gepids and Getae have nothing to do with each other, while simultaneously being a distant relative to the Goths. In this history, the Gepids, who had not taken part in the attack at Marcianopolis, were extremely envious of the riches obtained by their Gothic counterpart, and their king, a certain Fastida, the first Gepid king to ever be mentioned, demanded some more land from Ostrogoza. Of course, Ostrogoza denied his wish, and they met in battle in around 248 at Galtis, near the river Aua, whose location is unknown. The battle lasted less than a day, and Fastida had to leave humiliated as most of his army had been routed or killed by the Goths. Ostrogoza would supposedly die not much later, being succeeded by Gniva. And that would be all. Until the time to narrate Gniva's attacks on Rome arrives, there's a rocky road of usurpers to go through first, so next time we'll be focusing on them. Thank you for watching.